Dear students, good morning. Welcome to DEEP, Daily Editorial Enrichment Program of Law Excellence IAS. Let us start the discussion on today's newspaper, that is 18th May 2019. The first article, Charting a Clear Course in the Indo-Pacific. Here, let us try to understand what is Indo-Pacific and why is its significance growing these years. Let us take an understanding through this particular map. Indo-Pacific region, it consists of the region from east coast of Africa to the Americas. So this entire region, so these African countries and then Southeast Asia, South Asian countries and also Oceania region and Americas, all these constitute whatever we call it as Indo-Pacific region today. So this is a very wide region to be called as a particular strategic region and to execute a particular policy. President of United States of America has renamed the Pacific Command as Indo-Pacific Command. An Indian Prime Minister at Shangri-La Dialogue, he stated Indo-Pacific region as a strategic region. And the next, there are certain issues which are very prominent over here. Today, there is an issue of South China Sea. So, in the South China Sea, there are territorial claims for China and also Philippines and Vietnam. What is the India stand on this? India says overflight and freedom of navigation, these are quite important over here. It means any dispute here has to be settled as per the existing international laws, for which China has rejected the judgment of UN clause. In UN Convention on Law of Seas, that judgment was rejected. And South China Sea is a dispute growing in this region. And the next is, China is also sending its submarines into Indian Ocean and is developing the navigational capabilities over here. Especially, Djibouti is the station or naval station which it is developing on the east coast of Africa. So in this context, the China's strong presence in Indian Ocean is a threat to the strategic interests of India. And then today India has created a new division in the Ministry of External Affairs which is called Indo-Pacific Division, which extends to whole of this region. So here the most important region where a policy stance exists for India is ASEAN. In this context, centrality of the ASEAN and act-east policy will drive the Indo-Pacific policy or strategy of Indo-Pacific region for India. So in this context, India is a part of various regional groupings. One is Indian Ocean Rim Association, and then East Asia Summit, Mekong-Ganga Cooperation, ASEAN Regional Forum, and then the BIMSTEC, Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multi-Sectoral Technical and Economic Cooperation, Indian Ocean Naval Symposium, Africa-India Forum, and then there is a deepening of cooperation with Oceania countries, that is Australia and New Zealand. And India is also trying to be a part of Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation, that is APEC. So in this context, India is trying to increase its engagement with Indo-Pacific. Now, is India seeing Indo-Pacific as just a strategic region or also a commercially viable region? As of now, the strategic importance has been recognized, and commerce-wise, India already has deep relationships with the United States of America and then Japan, Korea and Southeast Asia. But however, compared to China, India is lagging much behind. In this context, President George Bush of United States of America proposed something called as Quad. So this is a strategic coalition of democratic countries in Indo-Pacific. This shall consist of India, United States of America, and then Japan, Australia. So these countries shall become a strategic coalition. Obviously, then it was seen as an containing policy against the China. So the region-wise, Indo-Pacific region gaining its significance, various strategic documents of the different countries are exactly reflecting this. So India also has to go forward with its policy, and bureaucratic rejig is necessary for this. In this context, identifying the strategic trade relations with the members of these countries is quite important. So, the centrality of the ASEAN and next, economic and strategic relations has to guide India's Indo-Pacific policy. And next, a referendum on the Prime Minister. Today in India, the more and more cabinet form of government is converting itself into prime ministerial form. So when cabinet form converts into prime ministerial form, obviously the casualty is accountability. Understand again, whenever a collective responsibility converts into individual responsibility, what we are losing in this, it is accountability. So here, the political party, as a political party, BJP as an individual, Prime Minister Modi, when they both compared, today the Prime Minister Modi grew over the BJP. And in this context, individualistic style of politics are being reflected in India. This individualistic style will undermine institutions. So this is what happened during the Indira Gandhi era. So India has to work on institutional integrity rather than individual populism. So that is what my point over here is. And the remaining, this article spoke more and more about Hindutva politics and growth of Prime Minister Modi and how these Hindutva politics are playing in Bihar and UP. Those are the things which are being spoken. For me, as per the UPSC syllabus, remember two points. Whenever collective responsibility becomes individual authority, then obviously accountability will be undermined. The second point, more and more politics becomes individualistic, institutions fail or institutional decay may happen. In this context, if the democracy has to sustain, institutional integrity shall have the primacy. Next is, it is with regard to European Parliament elections. In European Parliament, all the countries in the European Union can contest. In this context, all parties in various countries are trying to seek their entry into European Parliament. Normally in these elections, the percentage turnout is very less. But this time, Euroscepticism and increasing restrictions on immigration to Europe, these are taking upper hand compared to the centrist politics. Simply it means that the political parties are trying to take over populism, and the fear among the people over loss of jobs and also insecurities coming from the immigrants from especially Syria and all the countries. So the center right and center left politics are also buying into this particular populism. And the other kind of parties are green parties. These green parties are making climate change and the challenges of this as central to it. Next is external woes. This is about growing trade deficit. You know that imports and exports, they constitute the part of international trade. If exports are greater than imports, it is trade surplus. If imports are greater than exports, it is trade deficit. Today in India, the manufacturing sector exports, that is visible goods exports, are slowly decreasing and imports cost is increasing. Why the imports are increasing for India? The major reason is increase in crude oil prices. And the second, Indians are very fanciful about the gold. Increase in the gold imports, it is making this particular trade deficit to get widened. Unless we awaken and raise our exports and rationalize our imports, the trade deficit is going to be worrisome for India. That is the article's essence. And finally, thank you very much. Have a good day. All the best.